right, so what happens next? If the court agrees to grant search, then what they're going to do is they're going to they issue the writ of certiorari, and that's going to say that all of the court documents from your previous appellate court are going to be sent up. And then now the clerks, once they've read the brief, now they're going to have to weed through all of that stuff. And they're going to, like, extensively research and look back through. And a lot of times, some of the justices say that they go into the oral arguments with a decision already. So oral argument is going to be a date where your attorneys get, unless it's a special case, they get 30 minutes before the court. So they hear about 2 cases a day. Not every day, it's only like for a certain time period, like they have a calendar, and one attorney gets 30 minutes and the other attorney gets 30 minutes, but you guys, it is not 30 solid minutes. It is interrupted over and over and over. I really encourage you, if you ever get to hear the Supreme Court, because it's public, there's a limited number of seats, but if you can go and just kind of observe, it's so fun to watch them in action. And the one thing that I thought was really interesting is you can see the justices, it's like, yes, other people are in the room, but they're totally talking to each other. That attorney is just like a vehicle in a lot of ways. And they'll ask questions, and you can see how they're asking questions to try to get somebody else to, you know, hear them or make some kind of point. Another very interesting thing is a smart attorney, they really research the background of the Supreme Court justices, and they have a target audience. You know, they think about who they're talking to. Several years ago, there was a case that came out of Texas that was a case involving the power of the police and what they could do, and it was a stupid behavior on the part of the police. Like, they had done something really bad. But if the court had ruled in favor of the person who had been arrested, it really would limit police power, and it could have been a very dangerous precedent that could have been established, like, in the eyes of the government. So I saw the state attorney general who had argued that before the Supreme Court. And he said he knew that if he could get Justice Souter on his side, that he could win the case. Justice Souter had been a district attorney prior to being a federal judge. He had worked with police, and he really, even though he was quite liberal, he really had an understanding of police power and what police needed in order to be able to do their job. And so the state attorney general that I saw, like he said, he tailored his entire argument to Justice Souter the whole time, because he knew that that would really be like where the power is. So after oral arguments, then that's it. And a couple months down the line, the court will issue a decision. It's a written decision that has like legal summary and precedent. And some of them are really hard to read. You know, there's a lot of legal jargon in there if you're not a legal scholar. You know, I'm not saying you can't read them, but they're fairly complicated. There are 3 kinds of decisions that can be issued. A majority decision is for the winner, and it explains why. So you have to have the legal, you have to have the why, not just the vote. If the Chief Justice is in the majority, he or she has the option of writing the opinion, or they can also delegate it to somebody else if they choose. A concurring opinion says, I agree with the majority and that I sided with them, but I have some additional legal reasoning, or maybe a completely different reason for I made that decision. So if, like, okay, let's say that Michael is the Chief Justice and he writes the majority opinion, then Erte can sign his name to the majority opinion and say, I agree, but then also write a concurrence, which presents the other issues. A dissenting opinion says, you're wrong, and here's why. So they found in favor of the loser. So you can have many opinions. Like, you can absolutely have 9 opinions on a case. That's not super common, but it's not uncommon to have at least 3 or 4. When Justice Roberts first became Chief Justice, he said he really wanted a lot of 9-0 unified court. It totally hasn't happened. We've had a lot of division. And really, there's one justice right now that most people say is the most important, and that's Justice Kennedy. Because before Justice Scalia died, Justice Kennedy he's kind of considered the swing justice. You cannot always predict his decisions. It's pretty safe to say what Justice Ginsburg is going to decide, and you pretty much always know what Justice Thomas is going to decide. They're very consistent. Justice Kennedy sometimes finds with the more liberal wing and sometimes finds with the more conservative wing, and so, you know, he's the most important one, and And in recent history, that's kind of always been the case, that there's been one or two people that tend to be more important. So I want to show you a short little clip of Justice Roberts talking about the importance of oral argument, and then we can go on to the rest of it.
Do you remember your first oral argument?
Oh, sure. Yes. Absolutely. A case called United States against Halpert. I was very nervous. I was very nervous when I did my last oral argument as well. I think if you're a lawyer appearing before the Supreme Court and you're not very nervous, you don't really understand what's going on.
And this is a question for all the members of the bar out there, I guess, and for all those attorneys who eventually find themselves lucky enough to have a case before the court. What is it that you wish you had known about the process when you were on that side?
Everybody tells a lawyer in that position, you have to answer the questions. Don't try to avoid the questions or distinguish your case in any way. I hope I did that when I was a lawyer, but the importance of that is very accentuated. I appreciate it so much more now that I'm on the other side of the bench. You have to appreciate that the justices are engaged in the process of trying to help themselves decide the case correctly. So they're going to ask hard questions. They're going to ask questions that don't put your case in the best possible light, and you need to appreciate that. It's good to establish, I think I didn't appreciate this as much as I should have, some dispassion. Yes, you want to have a certain level of zeal and commitment to your client's cause. The justices know that. But when they ask you a question about a difficult case, it's better to sometimes say, you know, I appreciate that that case doesn't support my side. I appreciate that that causes us some difficulty. Here's why I think you shouldn't rely so heavily on that case, as opposed to as soon as they ask us, you know, no, that case doesn't hurt us at all, and here's why. They like you to be part of the process that is helping them come to the right result. They understand you've got a client to represent and they expect you to do that. But if you can convince them that you're on their side in helping them reach the right decision, as opposed to something they have to push against to get you to give an answer, I think that's very helpful, not only to the court, but also to your client.
Aaliyah, what's the majority opinion? I mean, it is simple. Rachel?
So, when the court makes a decision, you always have the majority decision, and then you sometimes have the concurring and the dissenting.
Right. You would have to have a majority opinion if they make a decision. I guess if they didn't make a decision, then you wouldn't have one. So it's the legal reasoning supporting why they decided how they decided. Concurring is I agree with your vote, but for different reasons. And dissenting is you're wrong, and here's why. And you can have a concurrence to a dissent as well. And I will say, kind of one of the things that I think like such an interesting process is like, let's say that Aaliyah was writing the majority opinion, okay? And that Nikita, hi!
I was going to ask you, where's Mr. Hirsch's class, because he's not there.
He's a golf coach, so he's at, his class would be at the golf place, field.
Not here.
Station, course.
Okay, not here, all right.
Yes.
Awesome, I'm sorry.
I could not get the word. Of course. Golf field, place, green thing. Okay, so Aaliyah wrote the majority opinion. And like, let's say that they had their, after oral arguments, they came back together and they decided, and she's like, she's going to write it. And then Kieran's like, well, I totally don't agree. So she's writing the dissent. Well, as Aaliyah is drafting that majority opinion and Kieran reads it, she might go, you know what? I've changed my mind. So even in that process of writing, they change their mind. And you guys, they might go through many drafts of writing those. Like, this was very, like, academic, cerebral kind of work. Just because they've had that one conference and had that vote doesn't mean it's done. It might be like a couple months before they actually hand down the decision. And until that decision is public, we don't have a final, we don't know what their vote is. Okay? All right, these kind of decisions, we need to talk about this. Stare decisis is Latin for let the decision stand. let the decision stand. The attitude that a justice takes towards precedent is super important. There's no right or wrong, but justices kind of feel differently about that idea. Okay. So let's say, for example, Roe versus Wade. Roe versus Wade was decided in the 70s. It's a case that allows abortions with regulation, particularly like in the first trimester. So Justice Roberts is a very observant Catholic family man. Everything in his life would indicate the fact that he is not in support of that decision. But if he has respect for precedent, and I'm not saying this is, I'm just using this as an example. If he has respect for precedent and he, this concept of stare decisis, his thought might be that, you know, Roe versus Wade has been the law of this country for 40 years. And it's not his job as a judge to go in there and act like this, like, public policy slayer going in there trying to undo precedent. I'm not saying that they wouldn't chip at it, but they have this thought of, I'm not going to overturn it unless there's reason to overturn it, because there's been some kind of shift or change. Per curiam decisions are interesting. Those are decisions that offer no precedential value, so you can't use them to support a future argument, because the vote is 9-0 and they don't publish any legal reasoning. So there's no written opinion. So the precedent comes from the written opinion. So there's a winner, but there's no, we don't know why. Per curiam decisions are unusual, but they can happen. I really want to talk to one of the justices and ask, why did you take the case to begin with, though? But I suppose that something just comes out in the process. Uh-huh.
So does that happen with every single 9-0 vote?
No.
No.
So a 9-0 vote could be still, you could have a majority opinion. The reason there's no precedential value is because there's no opinion. And the opinion is where we get the understanding. Okay? All right. So what we'll want to do now, and we'll do this for the next 10 minutes, and we will finish next class as well. I want you guys to access this website right here. If you'll just type in bit.ly, make sure you do it right, /SCJ, all caps, and then bio. I want you to pick a couple of people who are on the court today. Be careful, because the retired justices are there as well, but it'll tell you. It's easy to do. And I want you guys, and you can do it as a table if you want, like if you each want to pick a different person to look at, and come up with a list of the things that you think impact the kind of decisions a justice will make. Just like when we talked about political socialization and what makes you who you are politically, something makes these justices who they are as justices. It makes them make the kind of decisions that they make. And so we just want to see if we can come up with a list of factors. So we'll spend like the next 10 minutes and then we'll finish it up next class. Okay?